This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey everybody, this is Razib Khan here with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast, and I am here with Dr. Jason Munshi-South, and we're going to be talking about rats. Jason, could you introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. I'm Jason Munshi-South. I'm a professor of biology at Fordham University in the Bronx. I also maintain a lab at the Lewis Calder Center, about 30 miles outside of the city.
So Jason, we've known each other, online for a while now, and so, you know, I know you're the rat guy. I know of you as the rat guy. I'm sure other people know you in very, very different ways. But how did you get the rat evolution genomics beat? Because that's what I think of as your primary focus.
Right, that has become a primary focus, I'd say, over the last 5 to 10 years. When I moved to New York, I actually was a tropical biologist. But when I moved to New York, I wanted to start some research on local systems. And my first job was at the City University of New York. And I decided I was going to study small mammals in the city, particularly looking at the native small mammals that live in parks to try to understand, you know, if their populations are still genetically connected, if they're potentially exhibiting local adaptation to the parks and that sort of thing. And I did a series of studies on a native animal called the white-footed mouse. Which you may have heard of, Paramiscus. It's similar to,
yes.
It's a related species, what Hopi Hoaxer works on. But what I found over the years is that more and more everybody wanted to know what was going on with rats in New York City. This was really the animal that was inspiring people, both scientists and, you know, just people I would meet out or friends, you know, that are not scientists. And I started to think about, you know, well, how would we approach studying rats in New York City? Because they're very different organism than the native species we're used to studying in little patches of forest and so forth. And so ultimately I decided, all right, we're just going to do this, even though I was hesitant at first, because studying rats in the wild is not a very common activity, or it hasn't been historically. But, you know, we pitched this idea to the National Science Foundation, and it turns out they really liked it and they funded us. And then we just started spending a lot of our time working on rats in New York City, and have expanded this to many other cities at this point.
Well, I mean, so you spend your time studying rats in New York City. So what's going on? You're just chilling out of the subway terminals, tracks?
That was actually the first thing we had to figure out, you know, was where are we actually going to study rats? You know, a lot of people do encounter them in New York City on the subway. They see them on the tracks, maybe occasionally. On the platform, which inspires a lot of funny responses from people. But it turns out, after talking to some of the folks that work at the Department of Health, you know, the subway is not actually the number one reservoir for rats. Most of them are living on the surface, and they may build burrows in the soil, but they're kind of at surface level. And then you have another large population that's in the sewers. So we immediately knew we were gonna have to be creative in how we obtain rats. And we eventually decided we were gonna mostly do our work at the surface and try to catch whatever rats were there, plus whatever was coming out at night from the sewers. The subway, we have one data set from a subway line that we haven't published yet, but that presented a lot of logistical issues working down there.
Yeah, I can imagine. You know, for the non-American listeners, you know, rats in New York City are kind of a, I don't know, they're kind of a famous cultural just phenomenon. It's one of those things you get shared with on some viral, you know, kind of like city news, the giant rats or swarming rats and all this stuff. And so I'm sure you get a lot of rat-related questions. But for the non-Americans, can you just set the stage for why rats in New York City are a big deal? Like, for example, I don't know if this is true. I've seen multiple debunkings. You know, people say there's like 10 times more rats than humans in New York City, which I think isn't true, but if you could shed some light on that.
Yeah, sure. Well, New York City has a lot of rats. Nobody knows how many for sure. I actually tried to get the New York City Department of Health interested in doing long-term population studies to figure out, you know, estimate how many there are and whether the population goes up or down in any given year, but they didn't really want to do it. You know, it wasn't clear what the benefit to them would be to know if there are more or less rats. They're still going to get complaints. I do think there are quite a few. I don't think the numbers of rats are anywhere close to the human population, which is over 8 million. You know, there have been attempts to estimate it that come up with, you know, a million or two. I think it's probably even less than that, just anecdotally, based on how I see rat populations using New York City. I wouldn't be surprised if there are several hundred thousand. And, you know, that I guess that raises the question of why are there so many rats in New York City, you know, assuming even several hundred thousand is a lot of one animal in an urban area. And I'd say that, well, the simple answer is that it's because of us, because of humans and what we do. But why is New York City potentially worse than other cities? Well, the main reason is the way we deal with garbage in New York City. If you know, people haven't visited and they haven't had the pleasure of experiencing this, you know, there aren't alleys and dumpsters in New York City in most places. So what happens is restaurants and residential buildings and other businesses collect their garbage inside, put it in bags, and then they put the bags out on the street the night before it's picked up. And this happens on a schedule, so there's pretty much always bags of garbage sitting out on the street in New York City. And that is essentially a buffet for rats that is available, and they likely can predict. They probably just know which night they're going to have which bags on which street. And of yeah. course, they also can take advantage of, you know, all the overflowing trash cans just from, you know, street level traffic and so forth.
Well, so what is going on with that system? I've never looked into it. It always strikes me as weird when I'm in the city to see that. Like, why don't they have bins for people?
Well, it's a good question. I think the city was just built up so densely that there weren't a lot of alleys. And it was too late to retrofit anything for alleys. Why they don't use bins is an interesting question. Basically, you'd either have to force people to buy the bins or you'd have to provide them and you'd have to maintain them. Rats can be quite destructive. Like, you know, if it's a plastic bin, they'll just chew the corners off near the lid or at the bottom. And so you have to constantly be replacing them. If they're metal, they get dinged up and damaged and bent so that the rats can just find a way in through the top. They're not sealed anymore. So that's kind of the issue. You'd also have to change the job of the sanitation workers who are used to doing it one way and following certain routes and at certain times. You know, they've talked about actually, you know, having some areas with a lot of rat populations put their bags out like at 4 a.m. instead of the night before. But then you have to pay somebody to put it out at 4 a.m. So it's just, you know, the scale of the problem is really the issue. You know, you've got 8 million people in all of these old buildings. And nobody has bins, and nobody wants to put, you know, get up it in the middle of the night and put their garbage out. So that's really why we're stuck where we're at.
Well, so you know, we've been talking about rats, but let's talk about what we're talking about. I think, you know, we're mostly talking about like the Norway rat, correct? We're not talking the black rat. We're not talking about there's rats in India that are pretty common in domestic areas. Like, I don't know, they call bandicoots or something. I don't know. Can you talk a little bit about the type of common rats that are present around humans? And I know that my understanding is the black rat was earlier in Europe, and then it was replaced by the quote Norway rat, which is actually from Eastern Asia, I believe. Can you talk a little bit about the phylogeny and like the natural history of the rat?
Yeah, absolutely. So there are several commensal rodents that live with humans and that have evolved to live with humans. And commensal, you know, derived from Latin, literally means eating at the same table. So these are rodents that live off of our food sources and live in and around our homes. And the main ones are the house mouse, which came from Central Asia and is all over the place now. And then several species in the genus Rattus. And Rattus is primarily an Asian group. There's 60-some species in the genus. And there are three or four major species that live with humans. So there's Rattus norvegicus, which is the Norway rat, which is the one we have in New York City. Rattus rattus, the black rat. Rattus tanizumi, which is, you know, kind of an offshoot of the black rat, is confusing taxonomy. Then Rattus exilans, the Polynesian rat, which has moved around with Polynesian peoples as they colonize those islands. And there's also, as you mentioned, there's the bandicoot rats in India, which are actually a different group. And yes, it's relatively well known at this point that the Norway rat, Rattus norvegicus, evolved in Eastern Asia, probably in northern China, possibly in parts of Eastern Russia and parts of Japan as well. We don't know exactly, you know, what their natural history was before they became commensal with humans, but they likely lived in grasslands and savannas, eating seeds and fruits and all sorts of things. Unlike many other rodents, Rattus norvegicus, also known as the brown rat, needs to drink water every day. So it's likely that their distribution was and still is limited by being near fresh water sources. And when you see them in other parts of the world, they often naturalize along rivers and streams. When the brown rat became commensal with humans is not entirely understood, but it's likely began pretty early on when agriculture was developed in China. And that was a long time ago. We're talking, you know, 11,000 years ago, maybe earlier, when people started domesticating and growing millet. In China, they switched to wheat about 4,600 years ago due to a number of factors, including climate. And so it's likely during that period that the brown rat began to live around humans and their agricultural settlements and began eating grain, and evolved to be, you know, living with us and as a pest. You know, the other major rat you mentioned, the black rat, you're right that it evolved in, it's thought that it evolved in India, and then it spread, it actually spread much earlier outside of India, probably in about 3,000 years ago, maybe earlier. They were already in the Levant in the Mediterranean. And it's thought that they spread, you know, over land, but along coastal routes, maybe on some ships. And then when they got to the Mediterranean, they spread through Europe initially with the Roman Empire. And then when the Roman Empire began to contract, their numbers declined quite a bit. But then they rebounded again as medieval economies began developing about around the 1200s. And so the black rat has a long presence in, you know, Western Asia and Europe. But it actually began to decline when the brown rat arrived. So we think what happened with the brown rat or Rattus norvegicus is that it spread out of northern China down into Southeast Asia, relatively recently, probably less than 1,000 years ago. And it's thought that that happened as in Asia, they were recovering from this climate anomaly and people began spreading down into Southeast Asia. But once they got to Southeast Asia, they spread quickly along coastal routes into the Middle East and then into Europe. It's unclear exactly when they got into Europe. They were definitely there by the early 1700s, maybe earlier. Not all of the archaeological remains have been tested, so we don't actually know which ones are the black rat and the brown rat. But once the brown rat got to Europe, the black rat declined pretty rapidly. It's not entirely clear why. But it's thought that, you know, the brown rat is more cold hardy and maybe has a competitive advantage over the black rat. They use slightly different habitats. So the brown rat will burrow in the ground, whereas the black rat will sometimes burrow, but it's fine living in trees or in rooftops and in attics and things like that. But the brown rat seemed to win that competition. You do find both species in some cities, particularly those cities that don't have harsh winters and those that are subtropical or tropical. Like if you go to New Orleans, you'll see brown rats, you know, running around on the street in the French Quarter. But then you'll also see black rats, you know, in bushes and stuff in other parts of the city. So they can coexist. But the brown rat seems to have this big competitive advantage. So the overall scenario, the black rat expands earlier, gets into a lot of Europe and other places, but then declines when the brown rat also expands much later.
Yeah, I mean it's weird to me to think that the rise of agriculture in the Levant, you know, you had these granaries and it wasn't rats; it was probably mice, right? That were the main pest.
Yeah, so the house mouse has a long history with humans, and it's a complicated story because there are a couple different species that hybridize and so forth, in those early agricultural areas. But yeah, that's the species that in the Middle East, like, you know, in that area where. That was one of the early centers of agriculture, that the house mouse, Mus musculus, became the major pest. And then in India and Asia, you had these rats that became more important.
And so, you know, just to, you know, before we jump to the genetics, in terms of behaviors, from what I've heard and read, you know, the rat is this way, it's kind of like, does it kind of excludes the mouse in certain ways? Like they're pretty aggressive towards mice, and cats don't really intimidate a lot of rats as much as, you know, mice are terrified of cats for obvious reasons, but with rats, it's not the same. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's basically correct. So you can have brown rats or black rats and house mice occupying the same areas, but they won't. But they'll subdivide the habitat. So you know the mice will avoid rats, presumably because the rats will kill them if they're too near, and will, you know, eat the babies out of their nests and so forth. I have found locations in New York City where house mice and rats seem to coexist peacefully. But the only places I've seen that are like near dumpsters and things where there's just so much food available. There's probably no reason to compete or fight. And then the only other places I've seen in New York City where you have mice living outside is where rats have been eliminated. So that indicates they can coexist if there's like super abundance of resources. But usually the mouse is excluded if the rat is there. And so the way they subdivide an urban habitat is the house mouse is inside buildings, and then the rats are primarily outside or in, you know, subterranean infrastructure. And they have different biology. Like I mentioned, the brown rats need to drink water every day. The house mice don't really. They can kind of just live, you know, in a cabinet or something and just have access to food. They don't really need to drink water.
Oh, wow. So in the wild, it's because they get the water from the seeds or whatever that they eat.
Yeah, that's right. A lot of rodents are pretty hardy to arid areas, but the brown rat is not one of them. They do need quite a bit of water every day.
Okay, so basically, the rats in Phoenix, they do not exist outside the city.
Yeah, that's a fair assumption. You know, they're probably, you're not going to find them in the middle of the desert unless they're near some sort of water source.
Okay. I've read that there are no brown rats in Alberta. Is that true? And why haven't they made it there?
It's an interesting claim. You know, this comes from the government of Alberta, and they've claimed for years that they're like a rat free province. And basically, I don't remember exactly the dates of this, but sometime in the 1950s, the government decided they were going to eliminate rats. And they had some fairly robust pest control programs that reduced the numbers greatly, and they claimed to be rat free. But I'm certain there are some rats there. It's, you know, coming in on shipments of lumber or other types of materials, but they do try to control them. They have one thing in their advantage is that while the brown rat is cold hardy, there are limits to that. So areas that get really cold and are relatively dry anyway, are not great rat habitats. So they, again, if you have really harsh winters, that'll cause a lot of overwinter mortality. And if they don't have ready access to water, that's going to hurt them as well. So I think they have kind of a head start in Alberta anyway, because it's a pretty cold, dry, harsh environment.
So when we're going to be talking about rats as we proceed, you mean mostly the brown rat, right?
Yeah, so we've done a little bit of work on black rats, but primarily my lab has worked on the brown rat. So if I say rat, you can assume that's what I mean.
And so before you started doing your work, was there a lot of rat evolutionary genomics? I mean, genomics as a field is pretty new anyway, but.
Not really. There have been a few attempts at looking at relationships among rat populations around the world using mitochondrial haplotypes, which is not really genome scale. It's just they'd use one or two genes from the mitochondrial genome. So we're talking about, you know, like 400 base pairs a sequence. That can be quite useful because it's uniparentally inherited, doesn't undergo recombination, but there are limits to what you can infer. And there was at least one study on a city scale in Baltimore that looked at how rats in Baltimore were related using microsatellites, these little neutrally evolving repetitive regions of the genome. But other than that, there hadn't actually been a lot of population genetic research on wild rats. There was kind of a golden era of urban rat research in the 40s and 50s out of Johns Hopkins, primarily focused in Baltimore. And they published a lot of great population ecology and behavior. And actually, you ask about cats, and they actually did some of the early studies that showed that cats aren't very effective predators on rats just because they only remove small individuals and they can't really tangle with the big ones very well. But there was that kind of golden era of I would say more sort of population ecology research, but not a lot of genetics. And there hadn't really been much genomics on wild populations at all.
So, when was the first Norway rat, brown rat reference genome published?
Ooh, that's a good question. I don't remember exactly. It was one of the earlier reference genomes. I want to say like in the early 2000s, maybe.
Okay.
I have to look back, but we're now up to like version 7, I think, of the reference genome.
Okay. And it's the same size, I'm assuming, as a human genome, like all mammals, right? It's about a similar size.
It's about 2.7 billion base pairs.
And so you got the genome of this Norway rat. But I'm assuming it was actually a lab rat, right? Lab rats, these white rats and these lab rats, are they all brown rats?
Yeah, so the lab rats that you see, the white ones, the black and white ones, and some of them are gray, are domesticated Rattus norvegicus, the brown rat. And we actually dug into this history a bit, and we tried to understand where, you know, some of this domestication happened. And the history is really fuzzy. The records aren't very good. It does seem that by the like mid-18th century in Europe, the people had domesticated brown rats, and they had, you know, domesticated them to where they change, you know, you see the white coloration, and they show that kind of domestication syndrome where they become tame and not very aggressive. And there's probably a lot of those classic changes that you see in other species. And then, you know, when the rat became a very common lab organism, wasn't until a bit later. The story in the United States was that sometime in the late 18th century, they had colonies at the University of Chicago. But it's not clear like to what extent they were that they were using rats from Chicago. They may have just imported them all from Europe. And then in 1906, there was a guy named Henry Donaldson, who was at Chicago, who brought some of those rats to the Wistar Institute in Philadelphia. And then when he got there, they established outbred and inbred strains of rats. They were using some wild rats for the outbred strains. And then they, over the years, shipped out hundreds of thousands, if not millions of rats, and people created all sorts of new strains. And sometimes they would breed them with local wild rats, and sometimes they would breed them with other lab rats, but the history got lost. And so, you know, these hundreds of strains were created. About 50% of them show ancestry with the Wistar Institute rats. But, you know, that's about all we know about their history. But they are all descended ultimately from wild brown rats.
Okay. Is there a reason why the black rats were never used as a model? Are brown rats better?
I don't know. I assume it's just that, you know, the brown rats were available in Europe at the time, because by then the black rat had already declined. So I don't actually know that anybody's tried to domesticate the black rat. It wouldn't surprise me if you could do it relatively easily, given their similar behaviors, but I don't know.
And so domestic rats, I guess, these pets that I see around, are they from a particular lineage, or are they independent domestications, or...?
They were also like they were part of the early domestication in Europe. You know, it was actually especially in the UK, it was a common hobby to breed animals. You know, there were the fancy pigeons that Darwin talked about in his writings, and then in the late 18th century, people were breeding rats to create fancy rats. And you can still buy the fancy rat breeds, which have various traits. There tend to be more like the black and white ones, but there are various colors and morphs and so forth. Where they actually came from, it's just not entirely clear. When we looked at the genetics of this, it seemed that overall lab rats and pet rats were heavily bottlenecked, not surprisingly, because when they were domesticated, they were at least partially inbred, if not intentionally inbred. And so you only have a very small portion of genetic diversity from Asian and European wild rats represented in any of the domesticated rats. And it's probably an opportunity, you know, in the future, you know, to identify wild populations with different traits and try to breed those traits into the lab rat, although that hasn't really been attempted on a wide scale yet.
Yeah, and let me be clear for the listener why I'm talking about this extensively. Rats, I mean, to not the same extent, but like mice, rats are rodents that are used as model organisms to study all sorts of biological issues. So I think rats are actually pretty big in neuroscience. You look at their brain, you could cut their brain. I don't think mice are that big in neuroscience, but rats are big. And then in genetics, they're more expensive than mice. So, they're used for some specific things, but they're obviously way less expensive than primates. And, you can't do certain things with humans, right? And so, rats are a model organism and they're a mammal. They got a decent sized genome just like us. Their organs are small, but they're within the same clade. So this is why I'm just kind of curious, because sometimes the lineage you select for your model kind of matters a lot, and we didn't really think of it when these sorts of things were happening decades and decades ago. And now, if we had to redo it, I think people would be a little bit more careful in their selection of lineages and whatnot to get the appropriate diversity. Not that it matters that much because they're not human, but I don't think it's something that people would ignore necessarily today.
Oh, I agree with that completely. And it's true, there are different fields that use the lab mouse versus the lab rat. And unfortunately, for our purposes, the lab rat isn't used as heavily in population genomics. So there aren't as many. There's a good reference genome, but there's not like a haplotype map. And some of those other deeper resources are missing. There isn't really a good SNP chip yet. But I think those are on the horizon. There
Okay.
are a few labs out there that are attempting to compare wild and lab rats directly in behavior and other traits, and maybe breeding, creating F1s and things. But not a lot of that has been published yet.
Well, so what is I mean, I can kind of guess from our earlier discussion, but what is like the phylogeny, the relationship of rats across the world? Is every rat lineage outside of northern China kind of a branch of the Chinese rats, and then it's kind of nests just, kind of like humans have this phylogeny out of Africa, everyone's just nested in Africa, and the New World is nested in East Asia. Are rats exactly the same?
It's a similar kind of story. When we started our work in New York City, one of the questions I wanted to answer is, where did rats in New York City come from? And we realized, we might not be able to answer that if we don't have a good idea of just the general relationships amongst rats all over the world. So I contacted dozens of people all over the world back in like 2012, and asked them to send me whatever they could. And so I had people sending me, ears and bits of liver and toes and all sorts of things from rats they had collected, mostly for public health purposes, to monitor disease and so forth. And we were able to get genotype information on those rats at over 30,000 SNP loci, which was pretty decent. And what we found is that the samples from northern China, and those actually had a genome that was already published for a different study. Those were the most genetically diverse samples, and that's kind of what you expect for the center of origin of the species. And also, the older studies that have been done in mitochondrial haplotypes, they have more haplotype diversity. If you look at whole genomes, they have more heterozygosity across the genome. So it does seem that that's the center of origin. It's where you have the most diversity still. And then it does seem that first, out of China, out of northern China, they diversified down into, or they moved down into Southeast Asia, and you see clinal variation from northern China down into Southeast Asia. And then from there, the story gets a little simpler because rats moved out very quickly, and you can see a pretty strong signal of that. So after Southeast Asia, they moved along this kind of like coastal route into West Asia and then into Europe. And what we see in the genetics is that there are two different groups in Europe, a Northern European group and a Western European group, that are fairly clearly distinct with some admixture or some ancestral variation. And then it's those Western European lineages that essentially seeded rat populations around the world, beginning in the 1700s, essentially as a side effect of European imperialism. Because these rats can survive long ocean voyages, though, they'll just live in the hold and eat whatever food's down there. And so they made it, and then the ship docks, and they just come out with the cargo or walk right off the ship into the city or into the port. And so out of Western Europe, you see ancestry with populations all over the world, North and South America, all over Africa, Australia, New Zealand, et cetera, and lots of islands. And so, you know, there's kind of a big bottleneck there as they got into Europe, and then it was just a few lineages that got spread out from Western Europe. You do see a little bit, a few areas that have evidence of mixed ancestry. So New Zealand, South Africa, the West Coast of North America, they show some evidence of mixed ancestry of that Western European group of rats, but also some Asian ancestry. So there may have been some rats moved out of Asia directly into those places, and they, you know, they admixed with rats from Western Europe. So those are particularly interesting. But, you know, most places that we looked at, particularly cities, only have one dominant, you know, evolutionary lineage of rats. It seems that, you know, they get introduced to a new place, they reproduce quickly, and then they probably basically exclude new migrants from getting into the population and having a big genetic impact.
Yeah, so it's a first founder effect. Okay, so, you know, we've been talking about the phylogeny, you know, the relatedness, the origin, the natural history, but, you know, I want to talk about adaptation and selection. So you have a paper, you're an author on a paper, Genetic Adaptation in New York City Rats, and it just came out, actually, it was published this year in January. It's in Genome Biology and Evolution, and, you know, I know you've done work in this area earlier. Can you kind of talk about, you know, what character, so with humans, you know, people are interested in immune system, digestion, all these things. I actually kind of noticed some of the same issues in the rats. But can you talk about functionally what would be interesting about rat adaptation and selection? Like, what are they adapting to? You know, reproduction, cold weather in cold weather areas, really bad processed food? I don't know.
Yeah, no, it's a good question. And this paper actually had a fairly long history. We thought about doing this study shortly after we looked at the global phylogeography of rats, because we found that, you know, most cities had a single population. And aren't receiving a lot of gene flow from other populations. So we thought, okay, well, this, and they're pretty diverse, so maybe they're actually experiencing some local adaptation, and maybe we can see signatures of that in the genome of rats in different cities. We only had funding to really work on one city initially, so we chose New York City because that's where you're located, and we had easy access to the samples. And I was interested in whether, you know, rats in New York City would show local adaptation to eating highly processed foods, that's one thing. Whether they would show any kind of signatures of selection associated with, like, living in a new environment, you know, like moving through, like some of these rats live in completely unnatural environments, like sewers and subways, where they're just living on our built substrates, you know, concrete and iron and so forth. And then also they're exposed to a bunch of pollution in the city, like a lot, like humans and other organisms. And they're also, we deliberately try to kill them with poisons and traps and other things. So I thought, you know, there might be signatures of selection associated with those traits. While I was thinking about this, I actually got an email from a group of grad students and postdocs at Stanford that had just been, you know, kind of brainstorming at a lab meeting. This was Dmitry Petrov's lab, about, you know, interesting things they could look at. And they had independently hit on this idea of looking at the genetics of New York City rats, and then they found some story about my work and just, you know, sort of cold called me, and we ended up, you know, talking about doing this study together. And you know, it was a long kind of road because there were multiple children born amongst multiple people, lots of different job switches and so forth, but we ultimately got this published. And you know, we used some of these new techniques that they had developed, Arbel Harpak and Pliny Pennings and Phil Messer and Nandita Garud, and we found some interesting signatures in the genomes of New York City rats.
Wait, so does this date to like more than 5 years ago? Because I know Nandita, you know, I know some of these people. I remember meeting them in the Bay Area in the mid teens, I guess, when they were at Stanford, and now it's 2021. Is that how long you're talking?
Yeah, I think so. So from the initial idea, we had the initial idea, then we sequenced the genomes, and then, you know, there was a couple of years of analyzing, and then it, you know, some longer to write up than we thought, because everybody, like all of those people are PIs now, remarkably, you know, most of them are graduate students at the time. Like Arbel's actually down the road from you at UT Austin, just started.
Yeah. I noticed that. Okay. So, you know, you got the sequences, they're all in New York City. Like, you know, what's the questions you're exploring? What's the methods that you're using?
Right. So they were developing a me they have been developing a method or a series of methods to identify selective sweeps that can accommodate detection of both hard sweeps and soft sweeps. And by a hard sweep, that's kind of a traditional selective sweep where you have a single haplotype that is favored by selection and thus becomes very common. And you see that as a signature in the genome where many individuals in a population have the same sequence over some block of a chromosome. And a soft sweep is where there are two or possibly even more haplotypes that sweep that are favored. And so you'll see it as, you know, two different sequences become prominent in the population. And they've been developing techniques that can distinguish between that based on these haplotypes that you find in a population. You can compare like pairs of individuals and see whether you're having one or more haplotypes becoming more common than expected. We had to adapt this method. They did this, not me. This is more their specialty. We had to adapt this method for rats to use genotypes rather than haplotypes because our data were not phased. We could have phased them using some statistical procedures that aren't all that great. But rat, as I mentioned earlier, rats lack a haplotype map and similar resources, so that it's somewhat hard to phase, you know, which allele occurs on which chromosome. So they adapted these methods to genotypes. So we looked at multi-site genotypes rather than haplotypes, and look for these signatures of hard or soft sweeps. And we did this in a sample of 29 New York City rat genomes. We sequenced them to about 15x coverage. Most of them were more than 15x. And then we also compared our results to analysis of genomes from northern China that had previously been published, with the idea that, you know, if this was something that was happening specifically in New York City, you shouldn't see the same signature in these genomes from China. And most of the sweeps we identified, you know, when you looked at the Chinese genomes, they had much more diversity at these locations, indicating that selection was not operating on the rats in China in the same way.
Well, so I do want to just back up one moment because we mentioned this a bunch of times, and some of the listeners might not know. So a haplotype is basically like you have a segment of the genome, and that segment of the genome has particular variations as positions in sequence, and that's basically telling you its ancestry back to a common ancestor. It's just a chunk of the genome that's inherited together, and recombination slowly breaks apart these associations. But it's like an association, and so when you're looking at you know, associations that are found together a lot, that's a good sign that selection grabbed a chunk of the genome and swept it upward. And you were talking about hard sweeps and soft sweeps. You know, this is why you study model organisms. Hard sweeps and soft sweeps are a huge thing in human population genomics in terms of trying to understand how adaptation and selection happened. And you know, one of the issues I think is you know, the effect of looking for the keys under the lamp. Until recently, you really couldn't detect soft sweeps very easily with genomic data because there was no genomic data, right?
Right. And you know, I come from a non-model organism background, and I've done a decent amount of population genomics, but usually on species that don't have good resources. And so it's kind of it was us meeting in the middle. I'm working with all these people that work under Drosophila and humans, and I'm working on all these weirdos, and I start working weirdo organisms, and then I start working on rats. And they're kind of a little bit disappointed in the resources available. And I'm like, wow, look at all the resources we have. But it keeps getting better, and we have more power to do these types of studies on more species as we get these resources.
And so, what was I mean, just overall in your career studying natural selection in rats, you know, because you weren't a rat guy from like day one. What has been the most surprising result that you've seen consistently?
I think what's really surprised me with rats, first, I was pretty surprised that there isn't evidence of ongoing gene flow between cities, that there seems to be this kind of like founder population that takes over. And some of the fine scale population genetics we've been doing is yielded some interesting results. You know, I thought rats would be kind of these big panmictic populations, or maybe just show like some isolation by distance within cities, where the farther they are, you know, apart, the more different they are. But we find like real kind of like they're somewhat subtle but recognizable breaks in the populations in individual cities that correspond to like certain neighborhoods where they don't have a lot of rats, where it's really clean and and there's a lot of pest control or due to infrastructure like roads and rivers. It was a pretty surprising to me that, you know, the way we build a city can influence, you know, basically what the structure of genetic variation is amongst rat populations in space. And you think about that longer term, we may be able to design cities that kind of hem them in or prevent them from spreading everywhere. I was also wasn't sure what we'd find when we actually, you know, sequenced these genomes, and, you know, I was a little bit worried we wouldn't find anything. I mean, that's an interesting result in and of itself, but, you know, I was hoping we'd find, you know, at least some evidence of local adaptation. And we did find, you know, I'd say more loci showing up in these sweeps than I thought. There were a few genes involved in pathways for metabolizing endogenous compounds or toxins from outside, particularly in these CYP genes. And these are known in rodents. They've expanded. It's a gene family that expanded across rodents, and it's often associated with novel diets. So like when a species moves to a new diet, especially if there's some toxic items in the diet, you see evolution in these genes. We found that in rats. It might be related to new diets. It might be related to, you know, dealing with poisons. We're not sure. There were some other genes along those lines. And then, you know, maybe the ones I find most interesting, but they're also the ones we don't know that much about yet, and it's going to require a lot of work to really figure out what they do, are some of these genes involved in the nervous system. And there's one called CACNA1C that we found as an outlier, you know, undergoing sweeps in rat populations. And that gene has been repeatedly associated with psychiatric disorders in humans. It's one of the strongest candidates we have for a number of psychiatric disorders. And, you know, it's one of those ones that, you know, there's the nucleotide changes, but its expression and so forth can be modulated by early life stress and other stressful events. And it's associated with a number of anxiety-like traits and other behaviors in humans. And we see this as a fairly strong sweep in New York City rats. It makes you wonder, you know, how is their behavior changing?
Wait. Are you saying rats in New York City are neurotic?
You know, that's kind of, you know, when you're doing these kinds of studies, you have to be very careful. You don't want to make claims based on a statistical result, right? Say like, oh, we found a sweep. It is in or near this gene, so it does X. But, you know, you use this to generate hypotheses. So when we see genes like this, you know, I start to think about hypotheses we could test, you know, and that's one potential hypothesis, right? That in a stressful environment where there are lots of things trying to kill you, you know, some sort of anxious-like behavior or something like neophobia, like fear of new objects in the environment, might be favored. And anecdotally, we see this variation in the population. You know, just we've trapped hundreds of rats in New York City. And imagine going to a new place where you haven't trapped before, and there's a bunch of rats, and they're kind of an undisturbed colony. If you put like a box with traps in their environment, you'll catch a few, like usually young ones, like the first night or two. But then it takes like a week to catch the big adults. And, you know, one hypothesis for why that is that they're essentially neophobic. So you put a new object in their environment and they avoid it until it's been there for a while and they kind of get over their fear. Rats are naturally very curious. It's one of their, you know, traits that correlates with their broad success around the world, probably. But there's also, it sounds paradoxical, but it's probably good to be curious, but also neophobic. So to be interested in objects in the environment, but to also be very cautious. And, you know, so that's kind of the hypotheses where these results lead.
Well, so one thing that that does come to mind is that New York City, I mean, large cities in general, but New York in particular, in the United States at least, like Indian cities are just off the charts, as you probably know on this. They're very loud. Whereas, like, you know, if you're in like a regular college town, there are rats, but they don't have to deal with the same level of ambient sound. And I just wonder how that affects their stress level and just awareness of their surroundings.
Yeah, I think it's absolutely true that there, you know, is some sort of baseline exacerbation of stress levels in rats in loud urban environments. You know, one place that in particular I've thought about this is in the subway, because you literally have rats wandering around the tracks while trains are going on top of them. And they're just, you know, in the little space between the train and the bottom of the tracks. And that's incredibly loud, and they're hearing this all day. I wouldn't be surprised if they're mostly deaf after a while. In which maybe they is fine with them because they can, you know, survive mostly through scent and a little bit of sight. But you have to imagine that's incredibly stressful. And also, I know from working in the subway a bit, you know, you blow your nose at the end of the day and it's full of black, like steel dust from the tracks. And they're living down there full time. So you have to imagine these kinds of environments impose a toll. You know, same thing with similar things with, you know, the rats living in the sewers or even, you know, at surface level, depending on where they are. You know, they're going to be some of the most successful colonies are going to be in places where people don't want to be for very long. And that makes you wonder, you know, to what extent they are they just suffering like physiological abuse and, you know, it just decreases their quality of life and reproduction, or are they adapting to this? And, you know, these genomic results can give you sort of a first glimpse of like maybe where to look next. It doesn't answer the whole question.
Yeah, I mean, one thing that I think about is if these rats are indigenous to New York City, like they arrived, say, I don't know, in the colonial period or something like that, the city has changed a lot. It's grown, it's gotten more industrial, it's gotten louder, it's gotten, I mean, arguably dirtier. I mean, it was always unhealthy, but kind of like, you know, horses are different than cars in terms of the exhaust. So, I mean, I can imagine some sort of in situ selection happening in these populations just because the nature of the evolution of the city, which, like, I mean, what's the rat generation time?
Well, it's not completely stable, but they could likely have, you know, 3 or 4 generations in a year. So we're talking about on the matter of a few months.
Okay, so I mean, in the centuries that New York City has been a thing, could be thousands of rat generation times.
Yeah, that's right. And in one way we have that we're trying to use that kind of idea is that, you know, there are a number of rat skulls and skins kept at the Museum of Natural History here. And we actually got permission to sample like little dried up crusts from the skulls and so forth, and then we're going to try to, you know, shotgun sequence those to see if some of these genes are different, you know, 120 years ago compared to today. That project got a bit derailed by COVID because we couldn't really get into the museum for a long time. But one of my collaborators who's doing that sampling, Yvonne Hecla, she's been there and sampled some of the skulls, and the next step is going to be sequencing some of those like 120-year-old rats. And I think that's something that you're going to see a lot more of with rats. That's kind of picking up steam, using these museum specimens or archaeological remains.
Well, so in the results that you have in this paper, you know, there's three different categories of genes, apoptotic processes, animal organ morphogenesis, and axon guidance. I'm assuming the axon guidance is this kind of like biobehavioral stuff that you're talking about. Okay, I can see that. Why would animal organ morphogenesis be affected? Are they getting bigger or smaller? Like, what's going on there?
Yeah, unknown. You know, when we look at the individual genes, like the names of the genes, those are the gene ontology categories. So, you know, all of these genes that have been studied in like knockout studies in mice or other organisms, they get a number of categories assigned to them based on what they do or what we think they do. And that's one of those, you know, that's one of the criticisms of these kinds of studies is like you end up with these terms and you don't necessarily know what, you know, what they mean or what traits they're affecting if they're not, you know, one of your a priori hypotheses. So I would say with that one, I don't really know. I mean, there could be some kind of, it could be an overall growth effect. We've done some studies on morphology that show like changes in skull size, you know, so there might be overall like morphological changes. With organ morphogenesis itself, you know, I don't know for sure. I could come up with stories, but I don't want to like tell too many stories that we can't really back up.
Yeah. Well, I mean, wait, what's going on with rat skull size? I mean, you know, human skulls have been shrinking since like 40,000 years ago.
Yeah, so the skull size, you know, we did an earlier study where we were looking at white-footed mice in the city, and we found that the skulls were actually getting smaller, where like the tooth rows were getting shorter and some of the other traits were shrinking. The changes in the rat skulls were pretty, like, they weren't huge. It's not necessarily something that you would, you know, notice just looking at a rat running around in the street, but it was, you know, it was statistically significant. And you know, some of these tests you can run that look at whether it's just kind of like neutral changes, like drifting around, or if it's selection, indicated that the shape variation in crania is, you know, potentially due to directional selection.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wanted to make sure I get the traits right here for which ones showed significant change. So contemporary rats had, you know, essentially their nose is getting longer, and they also have shorter tooth rows, just like we found in the white-footed mice. And the tooth result is particularly interesting. What we hypothesized with the white-footed mice is that they're eating like a higher quality or softer diet in the city. We thought maybe they're eating, and we're doing some diet studies now in the parks, that they're eating like softer foods or seeds from new plants in the city. And so they don't have to, you know, chew as much. And we think that's what has happened with rats as well. Like if you go from eating like hard seeds in the environment to eating like rice, you know, cooked rice and, you know, bagels and things like pizza and things like that, then that might exert selection on, you know, on tooth size. So you're putting in less resources to growing these large teeth. The longer nose issue, we don't know exactly what's going on there. You know, one thought that from mammals in general is they get these longer noses when they're adapting to colder environments. It's thought that, you know, the air warms as it goes through those longer nasoterminals. Yeah. But that's, you know, we don't know that for sure. I think the diet one is more likely to be something that we could test.
What do you see selection in spermatogenesis stuff like you see in humans, or are rats so well adapted already to that sort of like high reproduction that you don't see it?
We didn't see that in our results. We did actually find that for urban white-footed mice.
Okay.
You know, which live in denser populations when they're stuck in these little parks and their competitors are all extirpated. But we didn't actually find that with as clear a signal with rats. But yeah, I think that could happen. But like, as you mentioned, they're already so adapted to rapid reproduction that, you know, maybe you won't find that.
Well, so
it's one of the primary effects.
So this study is based on New York City, right? And, you know, you're already seeing kind of like population differentiation within the city. I mean, it's a big city, you know, but you're already seeing population differentiation in the city. I'm assuming you're going to be sampling other cities in the United States, you know, maybe in different environments. Like I'm assuming, for example, that if you did a comparison with rats in Miami, you would see substantial differences just because the climate's so different. I mean, is that your intuition or expectation?
Yeah. And we, you know, for our sort of neutral population genomic studies, where we're looking at the, you know, how rats and their genes are distributed across cities, we have actually done multi-city studies. We have collaborators that helped us and collaborated with us on multiple cities. We've done Vancouver in British Columbia, New Orleans, Salvador, Brazil. So we have kind of a range of temperate to tropical cities. That's one area you'd think that would result in local adaptation, you know, adapting to fairly different climates. You know, a place like Salvador, Brazil doesn't really have a winter as we think of it here, and New Orleans has a very mild winter. And then, you know, thinking longer term and larger scale, when we have the funding to actually like sequence genomes from all over the world and actually start to look at lots of populations, I think there will probably be changes, like a lot of changes in due to local adaptation and environment, like climate, possibly like local incidence of disease. We know there's a lot of variation in disease in rats across cities. And then also things like diet. You know, if rats are eating primarily human diets in cities, you know, humans don't eat the same thing in every place. So you might see differences depending on what specific carbohydrates they're eating or what other foods they have access to, whether they have access to more protein and so forth. You know, some of the genes we found in our sweeps, in our sweep analysis, were related to metabolism of sugars and carbohydrates. You know, we see this even in humans, right? That you see selection on like apolipoproteins and things that we found similar pathways potentially affected in rats, probably because they're eating a lot more simple carbohydrates than they would otherwise. We saw a similar effect in the white-footed mice we looked at, which may also be eating some human foods or other subsidies we're providing them.
Yeah, that's I don't know. I always think because they're commensal, because they live with us, and they're always around us. I mean, they're adapted to us. It's always funny to think about the hooks of like how they would adapt to human, you know, foibles and cultural evolution. It's like, oh, well, you know, these rats have like, you know, I don't know, bigger teeth because this population has less processed food. There's more fiber. You know, they got to chew more. I don't know. Whereas like, you know, another population is like, they're all eating spam, you know? I mean, rats are, you know, rats are omnivorous, but they like grain and they like meat, right? Sort of stuff like that.
Yeah.
Preferentially. I have a, before I let you go, you know, I actually, I'm just thinking of like, you know, these brown rats are pretty recent. And like in, you know, in films about the Middle Ages, there's always like rats all over the place. And I think they're black rats, right? For the bubonic plague. But for the brown rat, I can see why it's so common in a city, and even in like college towns, I still see rats. And like in Berkeley, you know, there was a serious problem with rats in bushes, rats running around. I don't know if it's still a problem, but are they really strongly affected by urban locality size and density? Because, you know, this focus on water and other things, it seems like the cities are pretty good. Like New York City has puddles all over the place in random places, and there's, you know, hydrants, fire hydrants that people are letting go in the summer. So I can see that they'll be able to find water there. But in small towns, yeah, there's water, but then, like, you know, where do you find the trash? And it seems like it's going to be a harder life there. So, I mean, what do you know about that?
Yeah, I mean, definitely I think large cities with very high human population density are pretty much prime rat habitat. We've done some collaborators and I have done a lot of habitat suitability modeling across cities to try to understand what factors promote rat populations in different places. And it seems that like some simple stuff you predict is really important, like population density. Another thing that's important across cities is like the age of the buildings that are there. So older cities have more rats, and that's just because the buildings are, you know, they just start to crumble a little bit, right, as they get older, and they have entry points for the rats. They have more places they can nest and get inside and so forth. So I think, you know, pretty much the best rat habitat has a lot of people and a lot of old buildings that aren't very well maintained. You also see strong correlations with socioeconomics, but that's kind of an umbrella variable for a whole bunch of other things that are going on in an urban neighborhood, you know, buildings that aren't taken care of and all sorts of things like that. You know, where people have less control over the material conditions of their lives, maybe. You know, in these smaller cities, I think rats will be, and you see this in bigger cities too, but I think the effect will be magnified in smaller cities where rats will be more of a local issue, like very localized. Like, let's say you have like a street with a bunch of bars that serve food, and it just gets like trashed every weekend, and there's tons of garbage put out every night behind the bars. Like, you're going to have rats there. But then if you go into like the more residential neighborhoods without a lot of, you know, food service and, you know, where people are taking good control of their trash, there just aren't going to be rats there because it's not a good habitat for them. And the people, if they see a rat, they're going to put out traps and they're going to try to kill them. So I think in those smaller cities, it'll be more like smaller pockets of rats where the conditions are really good.
Well, I mean, you know, we're recording this tail end of COVID epidemic in the United States. So, you know, I do need to ask you the question. I am curious. So there's all this stuff about how restaurants were closed and they weren't throwing their trash out and the rats are going insane and they're cannibalizing each other and they're swarming on the streets and, you know, they're attacking diners who are eating al fresco. I'm sure you saw the stories, and I, you know, I know that they're like fascinating stories for people, but do you think that there was an exaggeration or is there truth to that? Like, what did you see? I mean, I'm assuming you were in lockdown, but, you know, you have some intuition about rats more than regular people.
Yeah. So you're right. I wasn't on the ground in the city as much. Not very much at all during COVID. I moved out of the city a few years ago, so I wasn't even in my old neighborhood. But I was constantly getting calls from media and other people about this issue. A group of us actually tried to, look at like the 311 complaint data and where that was happening to see if there was kind of a shift in where the complaints were coming from. Like, were rats leaving the areas where restaurants were closed and like going to nearby residential neighborhoods, like desperate for food or something? That was kind of the narrative.
Yeah.
We didn't see a real strong effect. We have a preprint up. you know, it's not like, it's not a huge effect. There was some evidence that, you know, rats shifted location a little bit, but I think, especially in New York City, a lot of those restaurants were pretty good about like switching to delivery and stuff. So they didn't really go under. So they were still, you know, serving food and putting out garbage. So I think some of that stuff, you know, it's also kind of like a bias from people being at home, you know? So they're at home all day and they're walking around on their block like every day. And usually they're just going to work.
Yeah.
And they're seeing rats more, I think.
You know? Yeah. 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 We had, you know, we had an issue in our backyard. And it was like, I think it was because like, the neighbor had an open compost pile that they were munching on, and so they would just wander around the neighborhood. And you know, I mean, they're mostly nocturnal, right? But sometimes they get pretty bold during the day. What's up with that?
Yeah, that can vary. Sometimes that's actually evidence that there's a really bad problem, and the weaker rats are out during the day just trying to get some food, because like, rats don't like to be out in the middle of the day usually, because they're, you know, they'll get eaten by hawks or chased by dogs or whatever. So it could be a sign that there were, you know, a lot of rats in that area. And so some of the like weaker ones were coming out during the day.
Okay.
I used to see that, you know, you see that in some of the worst infested parks in New York City or DC or other places I've been, that, you know, it's really bad when there are rats out during the day. But I think there's also just some variation, like some rats just don't care as much, you know, and if it's like not a threatening environment, you might see them every now and then just out.
Awesome. Well, you know, I'm not a big fan of your model organism. Not gonna lie, not a big fan. But you know, I'm glad there's enough for you to study. I hope there's enough for you to study through your career. But then maybe we could figure out a solution to this at some point. I don't know. I mean, probably it's as simple as having like very very durable bins would fix this problem in, I think, like 75-80% of the United States.
I agree. And, you know, you often hear people talking about like, oh, we need to develop gene drives to sterilize them all, or, you know, design drones that will like just operate autonomously and kill them in the environment. But really, it's just like you said, it's simple changes in human behavior would go a long way to controlling rats. Like you remove their access to food, you're going to have a lot less rats.
Yeah, that's the issue. I mean, when you have pests, it's because you're allowing them to eat and thrive and survive. So it's on you. That's on us. You know, it's not about the rats. The rats do what they will. You know, it's on us to like take care of our stuff and not be slobs, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
All right. Thank you, Jason. I will see you online.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Razib. A lot of fun.
This podcast for kids.